Well, let us begin with a word of prayer, and we'll dive in. Father, I thank you for this wonderful day you've given us, and I thank you for your word. And I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would truly cover us and prepare us to hear your word, so that we will act upon it and we will live in the truth of your word. So, Lord, come here and be in our midst, heal our diseases, forgive our sins. And may we walk in your light. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, when God created the world in the vast emptiness, he formed, he shaped, and he carved. He called, he imagined, and he revealed. He separated light from darkness, water from water, and created dry ground. In the seas, fish, whales, and sea creatures of all shapes and sizes began their lives swimming and rejoicing. The skies were filled with all kinds of birds and clouds. Certain birds would swoop down and circle and twist through the sky, expressing their freedom and their freedom of flight. On the ground, God created animals, all kinds of animals, deer, elk, elephants, lizards, and sheep. They grazed, they walked, they leapt and danced. They chortled and brayed. Life was amazing, and the echoes of their language became sweet music to the ears of God. He smiled at his creation. It was good. The flowers bloomed and the grasses lay like carpet. The trees embraced the sunshine and the leaves danced in the wind. The chorus of creation could be heard. It echoed, it reverberated, and worshiped the Creator. Then God paused. He was not quite done. He had one more act to do. One more act would be the pinnacle, the apex, the very thing he was working toward. He carefully formed the creature from the dust of the ground. He shaped and he carved. And there lay his creation like a statue, formless but lifeless. Not formless, but formed but lifeless. God then breathed into the man and he became a living being. The man arose from his mud home. He breathed and he blinked. He moved. Then the man heard the voice of God from Psalm 2. It says, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." That voice the man heard was clear and understandable. The man was conscious of God. He knew he was God. He knew that he was life. He knew that that God was everything. And this man was aware of his surroundings. He saw the birds flying. He saw the animals moving, the wind blowing, and the ant crawling. He saw it. He experienced it. And he was driven to the voice of God. His life depended on the voice of God. He held the animals. He let the bees dance on his fingers. And he marveled at the web of a spider. He ate from the trees the fruit it had given and produced. There was no shame. There was no sin. There was no death. There was no pain. Yet he was alone. And God said, "It's not good for man to be alone." So he formed woman, and there she was. God's creation was complete. Relationship could happen. But more importantly, life was happening. Worship was happening. And when the woman was presented to the man, he took her and he embraced her. And together they worshiped. And I believe together they proclaimed these words from Psalm 8. He said, "O Lord, our Lord, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avengers. When I considered your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you've set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The Son of Man, that you care for him. You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea. All that swim are the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth." Adam and his wife worshiped. There was no shame, there was no ridicule, there was no threat. Then, sadly, sin was found. It appealed to them. It pleased them. It gave them satisfaction. They made a decision to follow sin apart from God, based on desire, and they were lost. they begin to change and make decisions more rapidly against God's word. They removed God's word. They became afraid. They felt shame. They felt guilt and ridicule. Adam became weary of his wife and his wife weary of him. Division and separation developed. They hid. They heard the Lord God walking in the garden, wanting to commune, wanting to relate, wanting to simply be with the man and the woman. But something was wrong. Something terribly wrong. God called out, "Where are you?" God saw his creation dying like a dark veil covering the earth. He saw the effects of sin. He saw the man blame him. He saw the woman and he heard the woman blame him. He saw the lies. He saw the pride. He saw the inability to repent. They were no longer worshiping. They were no longer running to God. In fact, they were running from God. He could have struck down his creation, but he loved the man and woman. He loved them deeply, powerfully, and he loved them wholly. He cursed their decision, but in that curse, he gave them a promise. In Genesis 3, he says, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." God made a promise, a hope, and a prophecy. Yes, sin is here, but it doesn't have to be your destiny. God is going to make a new creation, a new people, a new humanity. He would send his son, and his son would make a new people and a new creation. He promised us the Savior, the Deliverer, and Redeemer. He promised the one who would crush the snake. He would crush the devil and the dragon. The promise was made. The promise has come. That promise was given and prophesied. It was hoped for, longed for, and expected. When Christ came to this earth, the promise was fulfilled. Christ is the promise. I want you to know today, Christ is the promise. Christ is the promise. Isaiah 53 is the prophecy of the suffering servant, the man of sorrows, the despised and rejected man. As we look at this chapter, we see that God has promised is given to us. We see that he comes to us. And it surely doesn't look like a good promise when you read this chapter and the suffering that goes on. God's promise, as you read through this chapter, can be easily overlooked, taken advantage of, and quickly dismissed. Yet he's the one through whom salvation occurs. Holiness is known, and the promise is fulfilled. God would send his Savior because Christ is the promise. First point, to see Christ, we begin with the cross. Let's go to chapter 52, the last part, verse 13. Isaiah 52, start with verse 13. "See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So will he sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand." We see the manger. We have the manger scene up here. We see the birth of Christ. We celebrate the coming of Christ, Advent. But we do not begin with the manger. We do not begin with Christ fleeing with his parents to Egypt, or the threat of death by Herod, the journey he took with his parents to Nazareth, the beginning of his ministry, the healings and the exorcisms, the parables, or the choosing of the 12. We begin with the cross. We begin with his suffering before we read of his parables, read of his ministry or journeys and the manger. The cross is where we start. It is the death of Christ that brings life and the resurrection that brings eternal life. Well, Jim Tucker, at the age of seven, sadly saw his mother beaten, brutally beaten and disfigured by a man who had broken the house and tried to kill her. When she was taken to the hospital, young 7-year-old Jim was placed in a foster home, and from there he went to juvenile halls, reform schools, and jails. He turned to drugs and alcohol and crime, making it onto the FBI's most wanted list. And in 1956, at the age of 22, he was sentenced to 90 years in prison. and to no one's surprise. He was facing over 600 counts of robbery and lawbreaking. When they slammed the prison steel doors behind him, his heart nearly stopped. But he swallowed hard, resolving that he'd be tougher and meaner than ever. Wherever he was placed, he staged one-man riots, taking on five or six guards at a time, destroying cells, starting fires, attacking and maiming other inmates. His chest was 54 inches, his waist was 32 inches, and he could bench press 400 pounds. They called him the animal. He was beaten, he was counseled, he was given powerful, mind-bending drugs, which would be given by four combat-equipped guards wearing special boots who would charge in the cell carrying a mattress in front of them to pin him to the wall. He received electric shock therapy, and time after time he was thrown into the hole, a solitary, soundproof 5x8 steel-doored box with no bed, no mattress, no bathroom facilities, nothing but a drain in the floor. And you're supposed to only keep someone there for 29 days, and he was kept there for over 3 years. In all, Tucker spent 27 years in confinement, never receiving one letter except a telegram with a sneering guard saying, "Your brother died." He was finally released from prison, but he immediately started getting into trouble, and the nightmare began repeating itself. He went to the top of a tall building, but he could not bring himself to jump. He went back to his room, and he opened the drawer, and there was a Bible. And he began to read the Bible. He began to read about the love of God. He began to read about how Christ came to this earth to die on the cross for him, and he rose again and saved him from his sin. He began to read about that God cared for him, that God saw him, that God loved him. And he began to cry. In all his years of confinement and prison, he had never cried. But now, like a little child, he fell asleep, crying, clutching that Bible. And through that message of that book, the Bible, the gospel message, the message of Jesus Christ, it changed his life. And then he went to prison again, but not as a prisoner, but as a preacher. With a burden for those behind bars, now he visits the jails, telling the inmates, "No one wanted me, but God wanted me, and God wants you." God changes lives. God transforms lives because he wants to change lives. He wants to change your life. He wants to transform your life. He wants to come in and heal you and bless you and encourage you. He looks at the sin-filled world and he sees sin-filled choices, sin-filled attitudes, actions, and behaviors. He sees death awaiting us, the judgment to come, and the inevitable destiny. And he sees the brokenness, the hurting, the dying. And he says it all. And when he sees that, and when he sees you, when he sees people hurting, dying in sin, he says, "That's where I'm going to work my next miracle. That's where I'm going to work my next miracle. I see that broken life. That's where I'm going to work my next miracle." He sees a poor decision. "I'm going to turn it around so they will know me and be saved." He sees a life that is dying. He says, "I'm going to make that person a new creation. That's where I'm going to work my next miracle." Because Christ is the promise. God wants to change life. Christ is the promise of changing life. You know, and as we read Isaiah 52, we see that we're looking at the cross. We see we're looking at the time of Christ when he's on the cross. Not the beginning. We're beginning with the cross. We're looking at him as dying, disfigured, and brutalized. He's on the cross. He's been beaten. He's been ridiculed. But Christ has completed what he came to do when he came to this earth, was to die on the cross. In 52:13, it says, "See, my servant will act wisely. He'll be raised and lifted up and highly exalted." We see that Christ, in the absolute depth of his humiliation, was lifted up and highly exalted. In the depth of his humiliation, was raised up and glorified. He acted wisely by being led as a lamb to slaughter. He defeated death by dying. He overcame sin by becoming sin. He gained glory through shame. In Philippians, we read this, it connects with Isaiah 52. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. He was exalted through humility. He was barely recognizable. He suffered immensely, but not just physically, but because of the sin he took upon himself. Not his sin, our sin. Here was Christ, the Son of God, God himself, who had never sinned, who had never known sin, who obeyed the Father implicitly, was disfigured by sin. His form was marred beyond human likeness because of sin. Sin took away Christ's appearance. You couldn't recognize him anymore. Sin crippled him and took his life. But at the same time, sin was crippled forever. For Christ, who did not succumb to the evil nature of sin, overcame it. That is why kings shut their mouths, why nations will hear the message, and kings, no matter how strong they are, will never be able to stop the message from being heard. The message of Jesus will be heard. His life-transforming message will be seen. And that's why he says in verse 15, so will he sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see. And what they have not heard, they will understand. Christ Jesus is that message. Christ Jesus is the life-changing message. He is the very thing that we need. He is the very person that we need to know each other and to know him. Christ is the promise. Number two, Christ is not comfortable. Let's look at verse 1 of chapter 53. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of a dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by man, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering, like one from whom head hide their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. What would attract us to Christ? How could someone like Christ be made known? He was a man who had no worldly status. He had no riches. He was not connected. He was born to peasant parents. He was born in a manger. He grew up in an obscure town, a town that even the Jewish leadership despised. He was not classically trained. He was not a Pharisee, he was not a Sadducee, he was not a zealot, he was not an Essene, he was certainly a rabbi. He taught, he preached, he healed, and when you looked at Christ, he had a common face, he didn't look important, he didn't stand out. He was an average height, average hair, average looks, just a regular average person. And there was no halo, there was no wings, he had no special markings. He didn't see him walk by and go, ooh, nothing that would have made you attracted to this man. He was simply a man. In 53:2, it says he grew up like anyone else grows up. There was nothing special in how he grew up. But the uniqueness was not in his human nature. The uniqueness was not how he looked. The uniqueness was not found in his connections to his parents or other people. It was not in how he looked, but it was his relationship that he had with the Father. The uniqueness was that he had a relationship with the Father that was unique, powerful, and beautiful. When you look at Isaiah 53:2, it says he grew up before him like a tender shoot. We're taken to Isaiah 11 in verse 1. It says, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse, from his roots a branch will bear fruit. Now, Mary and Joseph were both related to David, the king. Jesus was a descendant then of David. But unlike David, Jesus was just average looking. It was interesting that when David makes an appearance, his face is described. In 1 Samuel 16, it says he was ruddy with a fine appearance and handsome features. And the word ruddy there means healthy. He was handsome. Jesus doesn't get that description. In fact, he says he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. He did not look like a king. Look at Jesus, how he's described in verse 3. He was despised and rejected by man. He knew rejection. Most of what he said was rejected. Yes, he had many who followed him, but few who were truly committed. Even from his own entourage, he experienced betrayal. Even when he was being arrested and betrayed, his closest friends ran away. In the eyes of the world, he fell because he ended up dying in the most humiliating and brutal way possible. He felt those who hated him, and he was not esteemed. He felt that. He felt that hate. He felt the cursing. He felt the mocking. To the eyes of the world, he was simply a man that had to be quiet. He had to die. His message had to be stopped, and his life had to be ended. Here is Jesus. He came to this earth, who could have come as any kind of man possible. A man of power, a man of looks, a man of status. He could have come as a general who could have easily surpassed the campaigns of Alexander and Julius Caesar. He could have come through with might and power and forced kings to bow to him, men and women to worship him. And you know what's interesting? He did have men and women worship him. He did have kings bow to him, but not through might or power, but through the cross. He came as a man, was not esteemed or even liked, but today his name is highly exalted. Christ is the promise. Number 3, Christ began the battle. Let's look at verse 4. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. When Isaiah went to the temple to pray in Isaiah 6, his life was changed forever. In a vision, he saw the majesty and holiness of God. To say that he was overwhelmed would be an understatement. He was dying in the midst of God, standing in the presence of God. Isaiah was dying. There was no way he could stand in the midst of God's amazing and awful holiness. There was no human relief but God's grace. God forgave his sins and gave him a mission. Because of that experience, Isaiah saw God as he truly is. Too wonderful for words to describe. Too amazing to ever fully embrace in knowledge. He saw God as indescribable, all-knowing, all-powerful, and present everywhere. He said, surely the nations are like a drop in a bucket. They are regarded as dust on the scales. There is no one like Jehovah. There is no one like the sovereign God. And yet this amazing God tends his flocks, Isaiah 40, tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lamb in his arms, and he carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. The God who holds nations in his hands are like a drop of the bucket. Islands like a grain of sand, and the universe like a small sphere, sees our tiny world. He hears the beating of a baby's heart. He holds sparrows in his palm. He speaks of the suffering, and he comes to this earth as a man of sorrows. God saw this earth that he created, the people suffering in their sins. He saw them shaking their fists at God, ignoring him, following other gods, living at ease without him. He saw them dying, hurting, killing, envying, lying, and hating. He saw nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, might making right and division growing. He saw families crumbling, men hurting their wives, children rejected. He saw the effects of sin covering his creation. So he came to this earth. He took upon our sorrows and miseries and infirmities. The creator of the world, galaxies, planets, solar system, black holes, nebulae, atoms, cells, molecules, protons. And he walked among us as a man of sorrows. A man who took upon himself our pain, our sickness, our death, and gave us a new life and a new creation. God led him to be stricken and afflicted. The affliction was given to him so we wouldn't have to know it. Christ is the promise. Number 3, Christ's suffering is dangerous. Verse 5, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. You know, in the last part of verse 4, it says, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted because of what he did. You get that when you read verse 4, you think, well, Jesus, this man must have done something for God to afflict him, for God to go against him, for God to punish him. He certainly must have done something wrong. But at verse 5, it corrects us. He did it because of our transgressions and our iniquities. It was our iniquities why he was smitten by God. He was beaten by God, stricken by God. You know, when I watch the news, when I hear politicians, when I see the direction of what people think are right, it is easy to become angry and not love. When I get in the car and drive, it's very easy to not love. What are you doing? My children can get me angry, my wife, my friends. My first reaction is not to love, but to get angry or do something else. But you know what? My first reaction is not to love, but because of Christ, I don't have to follow my sinful instincts. I don't have to go with my instincts of sin. I can overcome them because of Christ, because Christ was crushed for my iniquities and pierced for my transgressions. I can do it because he brought me peace. I can do it because he's given me freedom. One particular Sunday, a visitor in church arrived early, parked his car, got out, and another car pulled up near him, and the driver told him, "I always park there. You took my place." The visitor went inside for Sunday school, found an empty seat, and sat down, and a young lady from the church approached him and says, "That's my seat. You took my place." Well, the visitor was somewhat distressed by this welcome, but said nothing. And after Sunday school, the visitor went into the church service and sat down. Another member walked up and says, "Hey, that's where I always sit. You took my place." And the visitor was even more troubled by this treatment, but still said nothing. Later, as the congregation was praying for Christ to dwell among them, the visitor stood. His appearance began to change. Horrible scars became visible on his hands and his feet. With the changes became more and more apparent, all in the church, for all the church to see, someone says, "What happened to you?" And the visitor replied, "I took your place. I took your place." Christ took our place. That's what you read in verse 5. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquity. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. Christ took my place. He took your place. Christ is the promise. Christ is the reason that we can overcome, because instead of us, he took our place. He brought us peace and he healed our wounds. It says, by his stripes we are healed. He has healed us. He has overcome our sickness. He has overcome our sin. Cancer has no chance. Sickness has no chance. Disease has no chance. Because by his stripes we are healed. By his stripes we are healed. He healed our hearts. He healed our broken relationships. His death brought life. He took on sin. He was crushed. But in the end, sin was crushed. Christ is our promise. Number 5, Christ exposed our identity. Let's look at verse 6. "We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." In the heart of Manhattan, in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, hangs a famous painting by the 16th century Spanish El Greco. The painting, titled "The Vision of St. John," was completed around 1614, but it looks like it could have been painted in Paris in the early 20th century. Its feel is not only modern, but also contemporary, evoking the opening of the fifth seal in Revelation 6. The martyrs who bore faithful witness to Christ are given white robes, while John looks heavenward toward the epiphany of the Lamb. The colors of the painting are themselves a startling revelation of another reality. But the painting was, as we view it today, is only a fragment. The canvas that hangs in the Metropolitan doesn't tell the whole story. In the course of a restoration project around 1880, the unfinished canvas was trimmed by at least 68 inches, or almost half the original painting. in the name of improvement, the scene is shortened by almost half. And so in what seems a fitting parable of modernity, the exultant arms of the Apostle John reach upward to nothing, to the top of the frame, to the edge of the canvas. The martyrs seem to receive gifts from nowhere, and John seems to praise the non-existent. All of them seem to look for something no longer there. As a people, we are lost. We are easily strayed. We follow our own heart. We think we're right all the time. We have no sense of what is good except what we think or feel. We're swayed, but feel we're not swayed. We are neither intelligent enough nor powerful enough to lead ourselves. We desperately need God. We will walk away from God. We will walk away from righteousness. We will walk away from holiness and morality. We are sheep wandering around, lost and misguided. We are easy prey to the enemy, easily captured and easily defeated. We have no shepherd. We have no truth and no reality. So Christ came to be our shepherd. We have a shepherd. His name is Jesus. We have a shepherd. His name is Jesus, and he will lead us to truth. He will lead us to holiness. He will lead us and guide us. We will never know who we are until we see Christ for who he is. Then we will know. We all, like sheep, have gone astray, but Christ has found us. Christ is the promise. Number six, Christ was truly human. Let's look at verses 7 through 9. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent. So he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And who can speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death. Though he had done no violence, nor was deceit, nor was any deceit in his mouth. When Christ saw this prophecy, when Isaiah saw this prophecy, he saw a man. He did not know the name. He did not know the theology. He did not know that he was talking about Christ. He did not know he was talking about God. He did not compute with how this suffering servant would overcome such a drastic and terrible problem that humanity faces. Isaiah saw this suffering servant and wondered who he was, what he was like, and why he had to face such a terrible fate. Or maybe he did have a glimpse of why he had to go and suffer. After all, Isaiah suffered when he stood before God and God saved him by touching the hot coal onto his lips. He suffered then, and possibly the rest of his life he felt the pain. But for an entire people, this was just him, but for an entire people, what kind of suffering would that take? What kind of pain would be required for him to endure? It's interesting that suffering is so prevalent in this chapter as you read it. It's like, where is anything good in this? Is there anything else besides? In every verse, in every thought, suffering is mentioned. Sin and death are that insidious. There's nothing optimistic in what this man seems to endure. But such is the radical nature of God's holy love. Christ walked among us. He did not fight back. He did not attack people. He walked to the cross willingly. He endured the people spitting on him, laughing at him, and the ridicule that accompanies the cross. He hung on the cross. He bled and he was maligned. He died. But in his suffering and death, he was fighting. He was fighting the very thing that was killing him. He was attacking the very enemy that lies to you and shames you. He became shame. He became ridicule and humiliation. But he attacked with great ferocity. Sin, shame, and death were given to him, even though he was not sinful, and he died. But let me ask you, what happens when you put sin on Christ, who is holy and never sins? What happens to sin when you put it on Christ? Sin has no chance. Death has no chance. Shame has no chance. Yes, he felt the pain, but so did sin. So did the enemy. So did shame. Shame was ashamed. Death was killed. and sin was made obsolete. That is why we look to the cross when we see the manger. We see the humiliation of Christ on the cross. We see the rejection by the world. We see the ignorance. We see the oppression. We see the judgment given to Christ. And when we read his words and see that many stop following him, we see the rejection of the cross. We see humanity declaring to God, we reject you. But in the cross, we hear God saying, I forgive you. Christ is the promise. And finally, Christ will overcome. Let's look at verse 10. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hands. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong. What an amazing prophecy of who Jesus is and what he accomplished. And this was written 700 years before Christ. Christ died on the cross, and then he rose again. What happens when sin is placed on Christ, who is holy and without sin? Sin cannot win. Jesus arose. Death lost its grip. Jesus will see his offspring, and he will justify many. Has he not justified many? Has he not continued to justify many? Will he not continue to justify many? He will be exalted. He will be cherished, and he will be worshipped. As we come to Christmas time, we see the manger. But in the manger, we see the cross. Because as Jesus was born, Jesus arose from the dead. His life shatters the myth of human utopia, the myth of human enlightenment. How is your heart today? Are you saying, I'm doing well, I'm having victory? That is great, but be careful that you don't think it's all because of you. Remember, God is the one who has given you your talents, your mind, and your gifts. Or maybe you're in pain, you're sinning, you're struggling, you're having sickness, you're lost, you're strained. Remember verse 5, by his wounds we are healed. By his wounds you are healed. There is no other truth, and there is no other salvation. We see creation, but now we see a new creation in the Lord Jesus Christ, because Christ is the promise. Let's pray. Father, as I read these words in Isaiah 53, I am amazed, and I worship, and I say thank you. I say thank you because of what, of sending your Son, and to live in this world, and to face what he faced. And you did it because of your love for us. Father, may your heart be my heart and our heart. And may we see what you see and desire what you desire. And Lord, I pray that you will heal and move and bless.